Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that is imperishable, uncorrupted, and unfading. Therefore, get your minds ready for action, being self-disciplined, and set your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you, the revelation of Jesus Christ. God is spirit and must be worshipped in spirit and in truth. The carnal mind is at enmity with God, cannot subject itself to the law of God. Given this, we should all be mindful to confess our sins on a regular basis, but especially before we would undertake to study the truth of God's Word. So let us take a moment to confess our sins to God our Father, to cleanse ourselves, and for Him to cleanse us of all unrighteousness, so that we can be filled with the Spirit, prepared to receive truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the grace that has gathered us together this evening, for the positive volition that has made this a priority. We thank you that you have still given us the freedom in this land to gather together in the open and study the truth of your word and speak of the things of God. Father, we ask that tonight you would illuminate the reality, illuminate the veracity, that you would show us clearly that the Bible need not be defended, but just set it free as a lion, and it will defend itself. Father, we ask that you would open our hearts and minds. Help us to see these things clearly with the Holy Spirit's help. Sanctify our time, Father. We thank you and praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. Last week we finished up our overview, our doctrinal overview, of all the areas that we would be studying through this series. So tonight it is a great pleasure to begin our study of bibliology, which has become my favorite subject. When I start studying theology, that'll probably become my favorite subject as well. So bibliology is the study of the Bible. We're going to look at inspiration, revelation, inerrancy, canonicity, and basic hermeneutical principles. This is how we, how it was studied back in 2004, and this is what you see in your basic doctrinal studies notebook. I have added a few things based on my own studies and my own convictions about what the current times would require, what the current times that we're living in and we're seeing around us, how we would want to be equipped, how the Spirit would be equipping us, and have added a section on apologetics, which we will be partaking of tonight. We will also be looking at, and we're going to mention all of these things in our apologetic study tonight, but we will also be looking at transmission and translation of the Bible. These are very important to understand and be able to answer the questions of skeptics, of critics, but especially those who ask for the hope that is in us, but ask it from the standpoint of only hearing the testimony of the world that says the Bible is unreliable, the Bible is untrustworthy. As I said in my prayer, quoting from Spurgeon, that the Bible is a lion. And you don't defend a lion, you just set it free. It'll defend itself. So we'll begin tonight. If you have your notebooks, you can open them with just the intro to the study of bibliology there. Prior to salvation, the unbeliever had any number of influences, molding and fashioning them to the image of the world. We saw this in our first night, in our second night of study. And we've come to Ephesians 2 quite frequently, seeing the children, sons of disobedience and children of wrath over and over again in this world. After salvation, though, the new believer is in need of being grounded in the Word of God, beginning the edification process of being transformed by the renewing of their mind. As again, we saw this in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. The importance of daily fellowship with God and daily fellowship with His Word. And that is how we are renewed in our minds, as we speak to God through prayer and He speaks to us through the Word. The newborn babe must take in the pure milk of the Word, 1 Peter 2:2. It is important, as we studied those first couple of hours that we looked at this, it is important that we understand that the new believer, the baby believer, cannot take in meat, cannot eat meat, but needs to be fed milk. The believer is a new creation, created in Christ Jesus for good works, Ephesians 2:10. And that believer now needs to be equipped for these works. That equipping comes through the Scriptures, 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work. And these are communicated in a local church. Ephesians 4, verse 11 through 13. He gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to a mature man, to the measure of the stature which belongs to the fullness of Christ. We went over and understood that the church is a family, a body that works together to accomplish these things. That we've been given in our part of the church age, pastors and evangelists, to lead us in the Word, to grow us up, to shepherd us, to care for us. But that does not eliminate the worth of the other spiritual gifts that are given. For indeed, all of these things work together to accomplish the building up of your brothers and sisters. A new believer must come to understand that the Word, that God's Word is 100% trustworthy and accurate. Psalm 12:6 says, "The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace on the earth, refined seven times." Proverbs 30:5 says, "Every word of God is tested. He is a shield to those who take refuge in Him." It is His Word, not the works of men. Luke 1:70, Acts 1:16, and so on. We're going to look at all of these passages in detail. God Himself has magnified it according to His own name. It is therefore worthy of our devotion and the means by which we can worship Him. Believers should strive to rightly divide the word of truth. 2 Timothy 2:15. That's a verse that we hear quite frequently in this church. Embracing the whole purpose of God. Indeed, the duty of every pastor and every teacher is to embrace the whole counsel of God's Word and to shy away from teaching none of it. We should be ready and able to take you from Genesis to Revelation and build your understanding of God, order on order, line upon line, precept upon precept, a little here and a little there. We hear that quite frequently in this church as well. And it's because it's important for us to understand that. I myself have learned the importance of this over years. The years of being in a hurry. The years of wanting to know everything right now. Of finally figuring out that I'm not going to be able to read the entire Bible in the space of a week. And I'm certainly not going to be able to read all six volumes, not including the seventh, the doctrinal summarizations and all of that, but all six volumes of Lewis Berry Schaefer in a week. But it must be line upon line, precept upon precept. This is how God designed it. This is how He designed our minds. To be renewed is a process. To be renewed in our minds is a process. And it means that we must take in the Word on a daily basis, a little here, a little there, as we grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. All right, so the purpose of our meeting tonight, and this, the full topic that we'll be discussing and studying is apologetics. And it is specifically to answer a very important question. The most important question that we as Christians need to be able to answer. Anything that anybody asks us, they ask us what we think on something or how we feel on something, we'll give them an answer. But then they might ask, why is it that you feel that way? And what is the response then? Because the Bible says. Well, then their response to that would be, the world's response would be, why do you believe the Bible? So what would be the most important question to answer? Would it be, who is God, or who is Jesus, or why is it important that we believe in Him? But these are all things that are in the Word. So the first question that we need to answer is, why do we believe in the Bible? Before we can get to what's in the Bible and why we should be looking at that. So the question is, why do we choose to believe the Bible? Being a choice, not just why do I believe the Bible? Why do I choose to believe the Bible? There must be a purpose and a reason behind the faith that we have in this book. It's going to be summed up in a couple of sentences. And those sentences I stole from another pastor, but that's okay because he stole them from Peter. And we're going to look at that, those passages. The answer to the question that we give has to be an answer that can be acceptable to each person that we give it to, which means that we can't give an answer that only works for us. What does that mean in simple terms? The answer can't be subjective. The answer must be objective. So if your answer to that question, why you believe the Bible, is because you were raised that way, that doesn't work, does it? We're all raised differently to believe different things. That doesn't mean that they're true. Okay, so what if our answer would be, because I tried it, changed my life? That's true. I did try it. It did work for me. It did change my life. But is that an objective statement? Is that something that somebody can understand in themselves? No, because it's experiential. Or as Schaefer says, experimental. Not sure how that works, but. So the question has to be objective, or the answer has to be objective. So your answer must be something along the lines of proof of the veracity of Scripture. Well, here's your answer. I choose to believe the Bible because it is a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies and claim that their writings were divine rather than human in origin. Let me say that again. I choose to believe the Bible because it is a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies and claim that their writings are divine rather than human in origin. Now, as I said, the man that came up with that, Vodi Bakum, stole it from Peter. So let's take a look at Bodhi's inspiration for those words.